well, I'm happy we have some time to have a little Q&A and discussion with our panelists. Thank you all for those wonderful and diverse presentations about the issues in the field. If anyone has any questions, we do have cards for you to write your questions on that will be brought up here. They're collecting the cards at the back, but just wanted to make you aware of that. I think that what's become clear to me after hearing these presentations and doing some kind of deeper thinking about this is that, you know, it's really a very difficult problem we're facing. And I think part of it is a Western way of looking at art and artistic influence. And that is that as a creative person, that the world is your oyster, that everything is there and everything somehow is fair game for you in terms of deriving inspiration and creating your work. And I think that's in conflict with a lot of indigenous ideas about culture and ownership of information and knowledge. And so I kind of feel like this might be the core conflict, because in a lot of native cultures, and this is something I've come to learn over time, you know, there's just some things that not everyone needs to know or should know, and that's okay. You know, that some things are not accessible to us completely freely the way other things are. So my question to the panel is, understanding maybe that there's a conflict in just a basic view of ownership of symbols and designs and materials, what can we do to kind of change that and bring more awareness beyond just the reactionary when someone does something terrible and then there's this response? So I don't know where to start. Adrienne, do you?
I think that's a very good point, and one that I try to make often too when I'm talking about these issues. But I think the biggest thing is what I ended with is just this idea of it's time to put the power back in the hands of Native people to represent ourselves in the way that we want to be represented. And I think through that process of uplifting Native voices and Native designers, then everything that we do as Native people is imbued with our values as Native people. And so that becomes part of the conversation. So when you interview a Native designer about their work, it's never just, yes, I think that aesthetically it's beautiful. It has the whole meaning behind it and the stories of where it comes from. And so it starts to bring that value system into the conversation around fashion and design in ways that non-Native and kind of Western designers are not engaging. So to me, I think through that process of uplifting Native designers, we're going to get into those conversations about values and reciprocity and relationships like I was talking about.
Mm-hmm. Adrienne, do you think that places a great burden on designers? That is to say, isn't there a point at which an artist wants his or her work to speak for itself and comes up and ultimately feels explanation fatigue? Because I feel like I love what you've suggested, and I think that's absolutely the best suggestion, but I wouldn't want to make that a prerequisite or a co-requisite to being a Native designer.
No, I totally agree with that as well. And I think I get explanation fatigue is just being a Native writer, a Native blogger. There's often the expectation, a Native scholar, that when I do scholarship, it somehow has to have this kind of undergirding of Cherokee spirituality or something to talk about my frameworks of higher education or whatever it is. So I do think that there is a tension there. And it's hard because we're at the kind of cusp of this, we're at the forefront. And so this first wave of Native designers might have to take a lot more of that burden than those who come after. And that's when I do my work in scholarship, that's what I'm thinking about, is like the next younger Native scholar isn't going to have to deal with this in the same way that I am. But that's kind of the optimistic viewpoint. But I agree that I think in many of these spaces, Native people get held to very different standards. And we all have such different connections with our cultures as well. So as someone who did not grow up connected to my community, to be called upon to have this great wealth of knowledge about my community is not something that I necessarily feel comfortable with. And I think part of that process is breaking down those stereotypes of who is a Native person and what does that mean.
But great follow-up.
I think just to follow on, I think the explanation fatigue is extremely real, and it's something that even though I suppose I don't personally kind of produce any sort of, I mean, I write words and I speak, I don't produce art or fashion in a kind of a more tangible way. It's even something that I've found as, you know, a black writer and editor, having to have that conversation and having to take that on. But I think also what's super important and what I think like definitely needs to stop is the challenging of what I guess indigenous people or those cultures being appropriative have the right to be offended or not offended by. That's what I mostly find quite exhausting when writing about this particularly, and I think that's how, you know, I was found for this symposium. There's a particular article on Refinery 29 about it that all came from the root of me daring to be offended by that Valentino collection when I'm indeed West African by lineage. I mean, first generation, my parents are. So that is definitely something I think that needs to be kind of constantly challenged is, and the line really carefully drawn is not telling people what they have the right to be offended by, I think.
Mm-hmm. I think part of it is a lot of non-native people really don't have a concept within their society of sort of what sacred is and where boundaries are, you know, based on their upbringing and lack of colonial history, I guess it would be. They don't really understand, you know, this is the boundary for this and this is the boundary for that. Everything is wide open. So that's problem number one. The problem number two is oftentimes you have non-native designers who, as we mentioned, are inspired by native designs. And to me, it's just sort of interpretation. You know, if we want to get to native designs, well, we need to look at native material and take them and do our own thing with them. Where I come from, the different perspective, well, you don't need to do that. Instead, just work with native people directly. Because part of the idea of you can work with native people directly, give them opportunity, then through your company, because I hate to say it, the world is not about profit, then through your company, figure out through the projects that you're working on with native people, also how do you give back to their community. So it's not always take. It's also part of it giving back and also finding opportunity to elevate native people as well.
Can I follow up with you, Joe, about, there's a couple of questions here that have to do with your presentation. Well, I think that the reference to Karl May, right, that he's the one that sort of has really stuck in the German imagination and seems to have been the progenitor of this real obsession in Germany. Whereas in the United States, I think that people of a certain generation, you know, grew up with like Bonanza on TV and Cowboys and Indians, and as a parent today, I have to say those things are not on TV like they were when we were kids. And I wonder how, as you know, culture shifts and evolves, and those are no longer part of the popular discourse or culture the way they were, that, you know, maybe some of those influences will shift. Do you see any of that shift happening in Germany, or do you feel like that's really firmly entrenched there in a way that it's not here? Because there used to be a pretty active hobbyist movement in the United States, starting out with the Boy Scouts, you know, not starting out with, but really accelerated by the Boy Scouts of America. And a lot of their practices in the early 20th century. Do you see, you know, why do you think that it's still so popular in Germany and Europe versus the United States?
Well, in Europe, you know, you don't have direct connection with native people. You don't necessarily see them on the street. You don't necessarily really have any exposure to them. The only exposure you have to them is, well, I guess, what you see on television, some of the books that you read. And in my mind, they have gotten so far out of control that I don't think there's really any turning back, for lack of a way of putting it. Whereas opposed to here in the United States, you know, you have these fraternal organizations, the new Mandan Shriners. They did a parade a few years ago, and somebody posted on social media, and they just totally got nailed with it. And then, of course, you know, the Boy Scouts are starting to moderate. So there's a whole generation of non-Native American, this is going to be a lot of words here, American non-Native hobbyists. But this group is getting older and older and older, and they're not necessarily passing it on. So hopefully someday, you know, they will, that sort of point of view will no longer necessarily exist. But for Germany, I mean, I just don't see them, I don't see them changing in the long term, because there's some Native people who go over there and they become either celebrities, or when they criticize, they are often told by them, well, you don't really know your culture.
Well, this person actually wants to know if you see a, if you personally see a role for yourself to educate the German people as a whole and members of these Indian clubs. It says it right here.
No, I'm tired of them. I'm more interested in finding ways to directly benefit Native people. I'm not necessarily, I mean, I gotta remember where I am, and so I've got to choose my words carefully. I've sort of lost my patience with that, or hopefully they'll just sort of, I mean, there's only so much you can change with people who necessarily don't have their head on straight. That's my personal view, not the view of National Museum of the American Indian or the federal government. So I'm more sort of taking the other side of that. Well, how can we just more benefit Native people is what mainly my interests are.
Okay, all right. There's a related question here that's really, I think, for NMAI, and actually you're a recent employee of NMAI, or a recently no longer an employee of NMAI. But the question, it's been less than a year, Joe. This person has asked whether NMAI has a policy for providing access to the collections for Eurohobs. I don't think that we have a policy in terms of exclusion of certain people. I think that when people want to do research in our collection, we're not quizzing them about what their intentions are necessarily, if they plan to copy the material. I think it's really hard to tell when someone, you know, when we have researchers come into the collection, we do ask, you know, what they're doing, but I don't know that we've ever screened people with that particular question. I don't know, you worked in the collection fairly recently, more than
yeah,
I have.
Well, first, just to ensure I wasn't fired by NMAI, that's the impression she gave. Instead, I left in December. I'm director of Native American Initiatives at the Minnesota Historical Society. In the region has a large Native population. So that's, I didn't get fired. I left on my own free will.
You left us.
Yes. Having said that, I did work down at the Cultural Resources Center where the objects are. And although I don't work in the department, I know people would come in by appointment only, a lot of researchers, Native people, and they do set restrictions on objects that are sensitive in nature, sacred objects, those kind of things. And this includes Native people and non-Native people. And the only way that you can access those is with a letter from the tribal government or the TIPO, Tribal Historic Preservation Officer, of that particular tribe, giving you permission to look at those objects. So it's there's sort of safeguards in place within that sense.
Okay, now we've got a number of questions here. We're not gonna be able to go through them all, but one of them I think is a really interesting question. The question is, why hasn't anyone here used the term racism to explain cultural appropriation?
I use it online all the time. I think, so the interesting thing that I have encountered with 7 years of writing about race and settler colonialism online is that when I use the term racism, it shuts down the conversation a lot of the time. On Twitter, I'm more liberal with it. Because what we're talking about is racism. You can't have settler colonialism without racism. Like, there has to be some level of that involved. People online don't like to read about racism. So I started shifting to using the language of cultural appropriation to kind of open the doors to conversations. Once I bring them in, then I will start using the, I will start talking about race, I will start talking about its relationship to black and brown bodies and whiteness and white supremacy, but these are all things that if I lead with white supremacy, people don't read my stuff. So it's been a long process of learning to navigate the language of it. Apparently I was saying too much. Cut my mic. White. the other thing is that I want to draw the attention of the conversation back to colonization and back to settler colonialism, which we don't talk about enough. So to me, that's where I've put the focus, is trying to get people as comfortable with the language of colonialism as they are with racism, which not many people are comfortable with racism, but you know what I mean, like trying to get people up to speed on that conversation.
The popular understanding of racism is that it comes from a place of hatred and derisiveness, whereas the understanding of cultural appropriation is that it comes from too much love and too much acquisitiveness, the Me Too. So again, there is certainly elements of both. They're closely related, but because they come from, at least in the popular mind, different directions, I think that using the term cultural appropriation or cultural misappropriation is engages the conversation more.
I think I lived in Washington D.C. for 3.5 years and worked at NMAI, and the way that some of the fans of the Washington football team, that certainly to me was racism. But in examples that I gave, you know, with those our friends the Germans, and the Shriners as well as the curators, and I've been working on the Shriner stuff for years and years and years. Eventually, I got to write something. I just haven't gotten around to it. The more I look at it, the more I think about they want to be Indians. And there's, with all three of those groups, there's something in their lives that's missing. And through a number of their experiences, maybe through movies or the case may be, they feel that they want to be Indians. And really, at the end of the day, it's sad. It makes me, I'm gonna need a Kleenex here. It makes me sad because they're so desperate to be something that they're not, that they live that life.
Mm-hmm. I mean, mine's gonna be a bit more basic. I think it's implied. I mean, I wasn't really that conscious of the fact that it wasn't in, you know, kind of explicitly said in my speech, because I think the two can't help but be intertwined at its core. I mean, I think if you have any understanding of cultural appropriation, I think particularly historically, yes, but in a modern setting, in the fact we're sitting here having this conversation, I would think you would have the understanding that this is, a form of racism. But again, kind of what you said about it coming from a different direction, which makes it difficult to pin down, and makes it difficult to very particularly define. So yeah, I mean, I definitely think it's there, and I think it underpinned what every single person on this panel said in a different way.
Well, I also think that a lot of times it does come from a place of ignorance, but it's also about very much about commerce, and it's about making money. And I think if we want to be very high-minded about it, we can say the fashion industry is about creative expression, but the other part of the fashion industry is about making money. And my understanding is the industry moves very quickly. And so designs are churned out, ideas are thrown around, things are produced. It's a very, very quick cycle. And what we're asking the industry to do is to slow down and think a minute before they make some of these decisions, because we do know that they're not deeply educated on the subject, and it takes time to get educated. And I think that, you know, that's another place where we're kind of coming in conflict with the nature of the industry and what is resulting from this in this sort of plowing through. So I think that we're going to draw it to a close with that. There's so much to talk about. I hope that you all continue these conversations and definitely, you know, rethink your role as a consumer, even if you're not a producer. And I think we have both in this audience. We have a short coffee break. You can bring your coffee back in because we are going to start with our last and final panel at 3:45. Thank you to the speakers on this panel. It was wonderful.